Truth is way stranger than fiction.
War has been raging in Europe for 4 years. U.S. forces have been engaged for a year and a half. All along, America has been waging a secret war. The OSS has been training commandos to parachute behind enemy lines. One of the most successful of these missions was Operation Greenup.
Operation Greenup was made up of several men that were refugees from Nazi Germany that were Jewish. They did the amazing thing of going back to strike back at Nazi Germany, probably the most hostile police state in history. The team was led by Fred Mayer. Fred Mayer was daring and audacious, willing to roll the dice on his life to accomplish the mission.
It felt like I had my chance to do what I set out to do, to kill Nazis. That's why all the Jewish boys joined.
Hans Winberg, the radio operator, was the lifeline of the mission. Because a team behind the lines in Nazi Germany without a radio is absolutely dead.
I was 15, 16 when Munich and Czechoslovakia and Austria were overrun. When Hitler came, the Germans who fled Germany came through our town. We were very much aware of it, the evil of fascism.
Deutschland heil!
It started right away in 1933 when Hitler took power. The flags were the handwriting on the wall. All the public buildings, swastikas. That was the end of democracy.
Fred Mayer was a Jewish teenager living in Hitler's Germany. His father was a patriot who fought in the First World War.
My father kept insisting, oh, I'm a war veteran and all that, nothing is going to happen to us. My mother said, well, as Jews, there'll be no preference. And she was right.
But my father was active in the anti-Nazi party here. Jews were fleeing Germany. So my father was completely up to date and he apparently didn't trust it.
Hans's father decided to send him to America with his twin brother. A business associate agreed to take over guardianship of the young twins.
My father sent $3,600 to the United States, probably a year's income, an enormous amount of money. Whole family said to my father, Leo, how can you be such a nut to send 16-year-olds to the land of cowboys and Indians? The whole family was against it, except my mother.
Hans and his twin brother left behind their parents, younger brother, and extended family in Holland. They would never see them again.
I will never know all the details. I believe they tried to flee to Switzerland, and they were either betrayed or caught at the border. And my father was sent to a concentration camp in Poland, and my mother and my brother, who was at that time 16, 17, were gassed in Auschwitz.
Fred was one of the lucky ones. He managed to escape to America with his immediate family.
We were able to come to the United States just in time. From then on, until the war ended, Germany was my enemy. And I had no scruples doing my utmost to destroy them. December 7th, 1941, the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor. The next day I was in line for the recruiting station. I had a good combination, hatred and love. Hatred for the Nazis and love for America.
Like Fred, Hans was ready to fight as soon as he was of legal age.
one day before my 21st birthday, I became an American citizen. And then I was in the Army.
Fred and Hans quickly found out that Army life wasn't what they'd expected.
The sergeant picked me, you, KP. It wasn't interesting enough just to be another number. That wasn't for me.
The Army identified Fred and Hans as recruits with special talents. They had language skills, knew the culture behind enemy lines, and most importantly, they were motivated to take on high-risk missions.
Somebody from Washington came up to me. I hear that you speak Dutch. I say, yeah. Do you want to liberate your country? I said, yeah. All right, if you sign here, you can go and join the OSS. I'd never heard of the OSS.
Guerrilla, saboteur, commando. Americans are becoming increasingly aware of the importance of these names in the news of World War II.
The U.S. didn't really have until late 30s, did not have anything in the way of an intelligence organization. And we had a Secretary of War, Henry Stimson, who said, gentlemen, don't read other people's mail. And so you can imagine where the OSS started, with nothing.
The OSS commandeered the Congressional Country Club to train recruits.
This was the general tent area, as I remember it. That's where we did our demolition exercises. And we blew up some of the good trees.
These were the Dirty Dozen of the day. A motley crew of men from all walks of life. German refugees, a Luftwaffe pilot, a butcher. One guy said it perfectly. This is the craziest group of men I've ever been with. And they also shared a common passion of striking back at Nazi Germany.
The only thing you have to know is this. That is to have a gun in your hand, and aim it at a German and do this. That's all the training I'm going to give you.
But there was more training, almost a year of it, covering all the basics of guerrilla warfare.
Knife fighting.
Hand-to-hand combat.
Underwater demolition.
Burst code.
Parachute school.
How to use a pistol.
Working with explosives.
Night training.
How to own locks.
Very scary movies about venereal diseases.
Never anything about intelligence. That was strictly disruption of the enemy. And we put our hearts into it. They told us that slim chance of survival, would you still be willing to do it? None of us pulled out.
We would try to stay as low as physically possible and in between mountains as much as we could so that radar wouldn't see us. We got into trouble. We got into a downdraft so severe in the Alps that it took us down 6,000 feet in 20 seconds. Forced down by high winds. You were going down faster than you would have gone if you just jumped out of the airplane.
Keep your head down!
And then near the bottom of the gully, probably because the wind vanes were leveling out at the bottom, we stopped descent.
Once, had never jumped out of a plane before. I told them, especially on the glacier, there is no problem. They were just sinking a little deeper, that's all.
Hey, keep your head down! Go! Go! Go!
landed at 10,000 feet, so you can imagine how high we were and how cold it is up there in the middle of the winter.
We found one another immediately. We didn't jump far apart. And then we realized when we got together, we had no skis.
I couldn't see the canister that held the skis. They must have gone on the other side of the mountain peak. The snow was deep and we kept sinking in. The air was thin. You had to stop in between to take your breath. At one time, Hans was ready to sack out and we had to keep going. There it becomes a matter of life or death. You either go or you freeze.